When Siddhartha Gautama awakened and became enlightened and became the Buddha, he actually realized something that is the true nature of things. That is dependent origination. Dependent origination is not a Buddhist term, but is so central to what we talk about in Buddhism and how we understand it and practice it. Now, you may often hear the word dukkha, commonly translated as suffering in the West, as kind of like why we practice Buddhism. That's almost like looking at the rock or stone that hit you, but not looking at the person who threw it at you, but instead getting angry at the stone and not really understanding why the stone hit you. So dukkha is very important, but it is dependent origination, which is really the central concept in Buddhism. And I will talk about that today. And what's great about dependent origination is that it really can help you with your practice of Buddhism and also your faith and determination as it comes to Buddhism as well. So let's talk about what it is. And this is a big concept, more than a video could probably ever handle, but I want to kind of explain it in ways we can probably understand. So dependent origination is basically, if you want to think about this, causes and conditions. So all things are empty of a permanent, independent, unchanging existence. That concept of non-self or no self, we are just a temporary grouping of things together that is this existence right now we believe is permanent, we believe is unchanging, but that's the illusion, that's the delusion. So dependent origination basically is saying that we arise and fall due to causes and conditions. So we, me, you are in existence right now due to dependent origination. So without dependent origination, we wouldn't be here. So there are obviously, you can look at this at a very scientific level, there are things in my body, there's water, there's blood, there's nutrients, I can't exist without other things. I'm interdependent, I'm dependent on other things to keep me going, to actually have given me life. I need a dependent origination. So I could not just appear out of nowhere. I need other things to help me arise. But these won't last forever, so I will also fall. Dependent origination, causes and conditions. So another part of dependent origination is really there's no really beginning or end to this. It's a chain of events, but we sometimes look at it in very, abstract views, like, oh, well, this happened, so thus this happened, done. No, it's actually just this long chain of events that really don't have a beginning and really don't have an end as well. They're constantly building off of each other. So yeah, like two sides of a coin, causes and conditions, but it's this constant chain of events. So we're constantly experiencing dependent origination. So the reason why it's so important, like we can also see that with ourselves, but also all phenomena are that they lack this independent self. So they are impermanent. They do not have this unchanging permanent self. Okay, so that is really the core of this. We believe they do, but they don't. So all phenomena, not just human beings, but all phenomena are void of this self, this independent self that doesn't really exist. So dependent origination, causes and conditions. Now let's look at this sort of from the Buddha's eyes. So when he awakened, right, he said, he was just shocked. He was like, all sentient beings can become Buddhas, basically. All beings can become enlightened. Now, that's a really remarkable statement. And the reason why he said that was because he understood dependent origination. Dependent origination was really that fundamental understanding, which really everything just fell into place where he understood everything else. And that is really why he had enlightenment. That's why he had that awakening and enlightenment and became the Buddha, is because he understand dependent origination, not on this pure intellectual level, but this fundamental level, he really understood it. And so that's really what we're talking about. Now, we can also think of dependent origination in a similar way, because there's also karma and all these other Buddhist concepts, right? Think about it this way. If you're out there outside right now and you have a garden and you plant seeds inside there, right? Okay, well, the seed is inside that ground. But let me, before I roll any further, that seed is also dependent origination. If you think about it, that seed had to come from something else, and that came from something else and fed by other things. And so that seed just did not exist from somewhere. There's this chain of events, right? Okay, so you plant that seed inside the garden. Absolutely nothing going to happen without the right causes and conditions, right? So there are effects. So what happens, like, when water happens? Okay, that seed now is like, okay, I'm going to start growing, sprouting. So that's great, but that seed's not going to get anywhere without the right conditions around it. It needs the nutrients and the soil and everything else and constant water to kind of keep it growing and growing and growing. So we can kind of think about this with our mind as well. So karma are these, these intentional actions we do, right? And we have this store consciousness inside us, which is like that garden. You plant seeds inside there. So back to what the Buddha said, we can all become enlightened. We can all become Buddhas, right? Or Bodhisattvas or Arhats. So think about it this way. Your intentional actions, your karma, you're planting seeds inside this garden, this store consciousness, and the right causes and conditions will make it arise. So when we're practicing Buddhism, we got wisdom, we got morality, conduct, and we got concentration, typically called meditative concentration in that category. So when we have these three pillars of practice of Buddhism, right, we are actually arising the right causes and conditions inside our store consciousness to give rise to our own inherent Buddha nature. But what we often do in our lives is the complete opposite. We're planting seeds of greed, anger, and of course, we have this delusion about everything. So we're planting these seeds, and we frequently water those. We frequently give them nutrition to allow them to sprout. So what we want to do is obviously not allow those to sprout. So planting seeds, wisdom, conduct, concentration, the Eightfold Path of Buddhism, those three groupings right there, these are giving rise to the right seeds to sprout, to grow inside your mind consciousness. That of an enlightened being. We want to get to that point. So when we arise those, that is what we're trying to do inside Buddhism. And it's truly a very powerful message, and it's a very fundamental and again powerful teaching and practice in Buddhism, because it's telling you that you have full control of those seeds that you're planting. And you also can give the right causes and conditions to arise it when we're practicing Buddhism, we're meditating, we're chanting, we're going to temple, we're doing good deeds. We are arising, and we're giving the right cause and conditions to these seeds to grow inside us. Otherwise, they would just stay dormant. So we want to constantly do that. That's why we have all these Buddhist practices. That's why we have all these beliefs. That's why we have all these teachings. That's why all this occurs. It's just not out of nowhere. It is due to help us arise the right conditions for our awakening to become enlightened beings. And that is why dependent origination is so important, because often what we do, like I just mentioned, greed, anger, delusion, we love to water those seeds. And those are the seeds that cause that dukkha, that keeps us trapped in a cycle of rebirth, samsara. And so we're just constantly doing this because of our intentional actions, karma. We're often doing unwholesome karma. And so we're not really realizing, and we're constantly planting these seeds, constantly going, 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 and that's not the what we want to do in dependent origination. So when we're practicing right, this is the true way we should really be practicing dependent origination, because it's understanding that you, me, I, phenomena, we do not have a permanent, unchanging, everlasting, independent self. That is really what Buddhism is trying to teach us with our practice. Because as soon as we strip away, we get rid of that belief, that erroneous, that delusional belief, that's when we are able to start, everything starts to bloom. Just like a lotus flower. That's why it's so symbolic inside Buddhism. You see it, it's arising from that muddy water, that dirty water, but it blooms beautifully, right? That's your awakening and enlightenment. We have to give the nutrients, dependent origination, the right nutrients and causes and conditions to allow that lotus flower, your mind, your true self, to break the top of the water and bloom, awaken and enlightenment. And you can do that through dependent origination. So dependent origination is not a bad thing. It's just the true nature of what's going on around us in our existence, our life, our realm. But you have control over that. So in short, the Buddhist practice and all these practices, beliefs and rituals and ceremonies and the monastics and everything else is all there to help us arise, to give the right causes and conditions to the right seeds we need. And then as soon as we can do that, and just like the Buddha, he saw what dependent origination was. He understood exactly what it was. And that became very powerful, as I mentioned earlier on, because as soon as he understood that, everything changed for him as an awakened, enlightened being, right? When he's looking out at things, when he's experiencing things, he's no longer being, no longer clinging and grasping and craving different things, because he understood dependent origination. He understood why and how things arise and fall, causes and conditions and the effects and the change. He understood all that. And that was really important, because then as he interacted, as he went around in everyday life, and this goes the same for his enlightened followers, they're no longer affected by that. And that is truly powerful as well. If you think about it, you're no longer being affected by all these different things that were affecting you, which were causing dukkha, keeping you trapped in cycle of rebirth, arising of three fire, three poisons, gone, because dependent origination, you understand, is so fundamental. This is just a very, very high level, you know, overview of dependent origination. But what I really wanted to point out in this entire video is, this is probably one of the, I think, the best teachings inside Buddhism, because it shows you why we want to practice, why everything is happening around us. It is that person who threw that rock, that stone at you. We've been getting mad at that rock, that stone that hit us, and yelling at it, not understanding who threw it at us. Dependent origination, not necessarily a bad thing, but that's the person who threw it at you, right? But then we also realize when we look back, that was us. You know, so we are the ones doing this too, but it's all interconnected as well. So it was us, but there's also a lot of different interconnected elements to that as well. Nothing just happens out of anywhere, but everything's due to causes and conditions, and those effects right there. So definitely two sides in coin, but there's that chain of events right there. But we do have the power, have that power to truly understand ourselves, which is the concept of the non-self or no-self. This is a delusional belief that we are a permanent thing, that we, you know, we exist, and hey, you know, nothing else was due to that. We also know things were due to that, but we just believe like, hey, this is my existence. No, it's a temporary grouping of things. And that's, this emptiness is really why we exist right now. So it's a good thing. So do you have any questions about dependent origination? I'd love to hear about it in the comments below. Thank you.